Get ready to be inspired by the people, stories, and opportunities in Africa. We're a global community of Africans and friends of Africa with no boundaries. Together, we celebrate the continent's successes and help provide solutions to some of its greatest challenges. Impact Africa airs live every Sunday at 9 a.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. GMT at listenvisionlive.com. You can also catch previous episodes on iTunes and on the show's website, impactafricaonline.com. Connect with Impact Africa on Twitter and Facebook at @YouImpactAfrica. Together, we'll discover that the real Africa is full of amazing talents and great opportunities. Welcome to Impact Africa. Africa has long been associated with needing aid and handouts. Today, you'll learn so much more about this wonderful continent from enlightening stories, people, and ideas. Now, here is your host, Tope Fajinbesi.
Good morning, America. Good afternoon, Africa, and welcome to another episode of Impact Africa. I am very delighted to be here. I feel very blessed to be with you again this morning, and I hope that you will have a fantastic show with us today. There's a lot planned for this morning's show. We have got people from OPIC here, and you probably heard about OPIC, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, and you're thinking, they're probably like the World Bank. They have nothing to do with me. But they really do have a lot to do with you. If you have Africa in your heart and you're thinking about making some money while at it, you should tune into today's show and you should stay tuned. I'm also going to be talking to some very nice people from the Federal Government Girls College Sagamu Alumni Association and their plans to get girls coding in Nigeria. This is going to be really fantastic. I'm going to be talking to Startup Africa. It's going to be really, really wonderful and inspiring. So if you really want to impact Africa, this is the show to be on. So sit back, relax, and enjoy this. But we'll start today with Ije Reads the News. And you know, Ije, she has got the best compilation anywhere in the world. So get ready. Well, the first thing we're going to start with is that on April 13, the African Union Chairperson, Dr. Lamini Zuma, and the Secretary of State in the U.S., John Kerry, signed a historic memorandum of understanding expressing each party's commitment to the creation of an African Center for Disease Control and Prevention. And this is just really welcome after all the Ebola, you know, problems that some countries are still trying to get over. So this is going to be great. They're going to be working with the CDC, and the U.S. will provide some technical advice and a few staff for the agency. We're looking forward to, you know, a proactive reaction or a proactive management of some of the, you know, disease issues that are plaguing the continent of Africa. So this is really great. The next news that really warms my heart is that a Kenyan mother, Phyllis Omido, was just awarded the Goldman Environmental Prize at a ceremony in the United States. This prize is the world's largest award recognizing grassroots environmental activists. You know, people have called Phyllis the Erin Brockovich of East Africa, and I think I would agree because I listened to her interview, and this was really great. Her own son was sick, and, you know, after some long and extensive treatments, her son recovered. But the experience, you know, set something off in Phyllis, and she became really an activist, and she began, you know, campaigning. And this, her campaign led to the closure of a plant that was causing lead poisoning, you know, in kids. And so this, honestly, you know, it's great because she didn't just solve her own problem. She decided to go ahead and help other people solve their problems as well. You know, so she, like Erin Brockovich, she's a testament to the saying that well-behaved women seldom make history, because she was really a rebel. The smelter was closed, but then it was reopened after they lobbied, and then she went back on the streets and campaigned, and now she's being recognized for this. This is really great. Congratulations, Phyllis Omido. The next news is, you know how I feel when things are about Nigeria. So I'm going to say this with a big smile on my face. If you haven't heard about one of the biggest and consistently highly ranked business schools, it's IESE Business School. It's, you know, always ranked as, you know, top 10 at least in the world. They now have the first African, as in the first African ever, to become a member of the International Advisory Board. And this is a very selective board. And this first African ever is a woman, and she is from Nigeria. Mrs. Ibukun Awoshika of the Chair Center has been announced as a member of that advisory board. That is just, you know, fantastic. Congratulations. And I think she's a great woman, and this is well deserved. So moving on, the woman who designed the Ghanaian national flag is dead. She died at the age of 92. Her name is Mrs. Theodosia Oko. And this is her on the screen. She designed the beautiful Black Star flag of Ghana. This is, we hope that she rests in peace. And this is, the next news is kind of funny. it's very funny. News number four. The legendary trumpeter, you know him, Hugh Masekela. He was at Rhodes University, and he was getting an award, and he refused to take, he said he doesn't take pictures with women with weaves. Yep, that's what he said. I think there was a lady who was supposed to take a picture with him, and he said, you know, you're very lucky we're here and they've arranged me to take a picture beside you, because if they didn't do that, I wouldn't have taken a picture with you. I don't take pictures with girls who have something like what you have on your head. Then he went on at the press conference to talk about, you know, we spend about R1 billion on other people's hair each year. I don't even know where to begin on this issue. He probably feels very strongly about this matter, because he was receiving a honorary doctorate. But so if you know you have a weave, please don't go near Hugh Masekela. So that's it for other news about Africa and indeed the rest of the world. Please go to IJ Reads the News on Facebook. IJ Reads the News. Thank you very much, Ijoma, for the wonderful news. So we will show you a little video, and when I come back, I'll talk about that video. And it's about the Film Academy that is going to take place, already starting to take place in Ghana, in conjunction with iSpace Ghana. Please don't go away.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Frimpong, and I am the founder of RUAL, a nonprofit organization that was founded in 2007 to work with independent filmmakers and also engage audiences for free programs and film screenings across the globe. So this year, we're so excited to be partnering with iSpace in Ghana, and we're going to be kicking off our first beta project, which is called RUAL Film Academy, and we'll also be doing monthly film screenings. So we're just really excited to engage you all in this project that will start March 2015 on the 20th. And it will go all the way until July 17th, 2015, this summer. And all the programs affiliated with the RUAL Film Academy are free to the public. So basically, the first part of the Film Academy is going to be our film lab and our workshops. We'll have two workshops and we'll have one film lab. And all of these programs are going to be available to the public either virtually or live. And you'll be able to register for any of the programs on our website, which is www.rwul.com. And then the other part of the project is the monthly screenings. So to get people engaged and to keep them talking about film, we're going to have monthly screenings at iSpace in Ghana. And those are going to occur once a month, the third Friday of every month. And we're going to have a different theme and prop for each month. And we'll have filmmakers that will be coming in to talk to the audience about the films that they're screening, and then also online chats where people can interact with these filmmakers as well. So we just hope to engage people in Ghana with independent filmmaking. It's something that is still fairly new to Ghana, and there are so many young creative minds in Ghana that are interested in film and cinema. And we just want to be able to get them to view their peers' work and to also engage with other people who are excited about the film work that they're doing. So please stay tuned for more updates and more details of the Film Academy as it starts to roll out in the next couple of months. And then make sure that you stay tuned for our annual film festival, the I Love Africa Film Festival, which will be in October this year. And we'll have open submissions accepting films of all genres starting later this spring. So I'm just really excited about it, and I hope that you all will join us and even participate. Thanks.
Thank you very much for watching that. And Rebecca Frimpong was supposed to be on the show with us today, but she lost her voice. She's in the hospital. I hope, Rebecca, you get well. But this is a very nice project to support, you know, not just to support the young filmmakers in Ghana or in Africa entirely, but also to, you know, bring arts and culture and bring some appreciation for this in the continent. So if you want to support, please go to www.rwul.com. rwul.com. So once again, this is the Rural Film Academy in partnership with iSpace Ghana. And the person that is pushing this here is Rebecca Frimpong. I hope she'll be on the show later on, you know, in the year. But the film festival already started. I think March was the first one. And there will be screenings in Ghana, free to public, every last Friday, I believe, of the month. So please support them. Before I bring on my next guest from Startup Africa, I want to show you a little video as well from what the kind of work that they're doing in Kenya. Please stay with us.
My name is Steve Butiano, representing on Humacol Entrepreneurial Venture. We shall be able to prevent environmental degradation. This is how we are going to do it. By first of all constructing public toilets from where we are going to dump the waste into a treatment tank whereby we are going to add ash into the slide so as to bind the particles together. From the treatment plant, the sludge flows into a dehydrating tank whereby we are going to use solar energy that some of the biomass produced from the treatment tank there to heat it to ensure that the sludge dries completely. Also, it provides employment opportunities to the youth in the slums, thereby helping us to cap the growth of rates of criminals in those slum areas. It also enables us to manage the waste effectively, since it is this waste which is going to be used in the production of this jam. Within the startup of the business, our immediate target market are going to be the slum dwellers and the low income earners. After a period of time, we shall be able to provide to the schools, the prisons, hotels, and even expand to the other slums.
The winner of this event is Mangu High School Team B. Mangu Team B.
Welcome back to Impact Africa. That was just, you know, so pleasant watching those young people compete for, you know, something so great. They are the future of Africa, and I'm hoping that, you know, we can nurture that future of Africa. So joining me on the phone from Delaware is Erastus Mongare of Startup Africa. Erastus, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Welcome to Impact Africa, Erastus. And I believe the video that we just saw was from the Diamond Challenge, is that correct?
That's very correct.
Okay, so what is this Diamond Challenge? What do you guys do with it?
So Diamond Challenge is an entrepreneurship competition for high school students. Started with the whole purpose of encouraging entrepreneurship from an early age of high school students.
That's so now this is the thing that, you know, I always tell people that in Africa we're very good at organizing competitions, and these competitions brings out so many talented people. There was a competition in Nigeria, I think in 2012, where some very smart girls developed this electricity power generator that will be powered by urine. But that was all. They won, and then nothing happened. So what happens next after these kids have come up with these bright ideas? What do you do to make sure that these ideas don't die after the competition is over?
You know, you bring up a very good point, which is not something just happens among youth, but also happens in many other competitions which college students are participating. And that is the question about funding to ensure that these ideas actually get implemented. At Startup Africa, we're very, very keen on that because as part of talking about our success, talking about our sustainability, being able to say that these ideas have been funded, they've been implemented. Since we started the competition in 2013, the competition height structured the winners at the international level can utilize their funds in two ways. They can either use them to implement the idea that they presented at the competition, or they can utilize the funds to go to college, taking into mind that these are high school students. So our winners in the first year decided to use their funds to go to college, which of course we count as a success. The winners last year decided to use their funds to start their business. So at least that is one way that those ideas are being implemented. But we are very keen on continuing to develop the ideas, because we realize that at the end of the day, we don't want to just say that we had a competition. We'd like also to be able to talk about what those students were able to do by going out and implementing the ideas in the different parts of the country where they're from.
That is, and that's very brilliant. And this brings me to the point about the diaspora engagement. You're obviously here, so you're part of, you know, the diaspora community. But if people like this idea and they're watching it, they're thinking, you know, this is what I really want to be, you know, involved with. I want to mentor these kids. Is there an opportunity for people in the diaspora to serve as mentors to these kids as well?
Yes, absolutely. There is an opportunity, and as part of our work, one thing that we realize is, and even in talking with some very successful entrepreneurs, they'll always tell you that there was somebody that was behind them that saw their success behind. It could have been a parent, it could be a neighbor who was successful in business, it could have been somebody at their place of work. So in the same vein, we also realize that if we are going to support these youth to succeed, then we also need to match them with mentors. So the mentors don't have to be in Africa. They can be anywhere in the world, as long as they have the passion to help those students succeed. Using technology, we'll match them with whatever team that they have seen that they'd like to give back to. And they get together over phone, over Skype, or whichever means, and they're able to get assistance as much as possible.
And I think that's really brilliant. So if you want to sign up as a mentor, I think you should connect with Startup Africa. And your website is startupafrica.org, right?
That's correct.
So startupafrica.org, would also tweet that out on our Twitter handle at @UImpactAfrica. But let me ask you, you know, of course, with everything that we do in Africa, there are always challenges. What is your biggest challenge and how are you dealing with it?
I'd say the first one is when we started, for example, the Diamond Challenge in 2013, was the acceptance of the idea in Kenya, where we piloted the project with the Ministry of Education, because we were dealing with high schools. I do remember when we approached them, Kenya was at that particular time going through a transition of the constitution, and the permanent secretary of the Ministry of Education then told us because of the changing constitution, we had to go to the county level to engage them. We visited a few of the counties. The county people told us, you know, just approach the schools. If they want to work with you, we don't care. So we decided to just go and approach the schools, because for us, we said we want to test our program. 2 years into doing the program, now we've gone right back to the Ministry of Education again to talk to them and say, look, our program is expanding so much. We don't want to be in all your schools one day and then you come and ask us, who are you? And at least they've been open at this time to engaging us, learning about the Diamond Challenge, which of course they like. But now going to the next level, that is getting an endorsement letter, memorandum of understanding, so that as we go into more schools, we won't face some challenges just like we face with the some of the schools when we approach this principal, and the principals ask us whether the Ministry of Education knows about our work. So I'd say that's one of the challenges. The second challenge for a small organization like ours, which is powered by the power of volunteerism, when we get on a good idea, like for example, the Diamond Challenge, which when we started, we didn't know it was going to grow so much, and then it grows so much, and then you realize, do you curtail it where you are, that you can continue enjoying where you are, or do you continue working on it, because it's a good initiative which has attracted a number of schools. In 2013 when we started in Kenya, we only had 10 schools for the pilot project. We now are in 131 schools.
Wow.
And then we have also taken the same initiative to Uganda with 20 schools.
Wow.
And we have about 5 other countries which are also asking us to take the program to them.
Wow.
But in order for us to go to those countries, we need the funding. So as a small organization, now we've started wrestling with how do we start looking for grants? How do we start looking for businesses which have a corporate social responsibility tied into education entrepreneurship so that they can learn about what we're doing so that they can come and support us?
Wow.
So that becomes one of those challenges that we are currently dealing with, but which I'm hoping that in due time, with good people and good support on time, we'll be able to overcome and continue to expand the program.
Wow, that I'm super impressed, and I'm very excited that you are even growing beyond Kenya, because I think that the progress of Africa will start when we start to reach beyond our own immediate borders and we tap into this collective strength of the continent of 1 billion people. Thank you so much. I'm so, you know, inspired by the work that you're doing, and I'm hoping that people will support you. And the website to go is startupafrica.org, startupafrica.org. Thank you so much, Erastus, for coming on Impact Africa today. And we hope that you'll be in touch with Impact Africa and would follow your progress as you go along.
Thank you as well for the invitation. And again, as you've told your listeners, startupafrica.org. And locally, we hold an annual entrepreneurship conference in the fall. This year, it's going to be October 17th. If you visit our website, you'll see the initial information about the conference, and they can be able to come, learn, connect with other diaspora Africans who are engaged in entrepreneurship and they want to learn from each other and share with each other.
And we will definitely share that information as the event approaches. So please make sure that we're informed. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you. Have a good morning.
Bye-bye.
When we come back after this break, I'm going to be joined by the gentleman from OPIC. And you need to be here to listen to this particular, you know, edition of Impact Africa. So please don't go away.
Listening to Impact Africa. To connect with the program, please call 1-443-499-2755. That's 1-443-499-2755. You may also send an email to info@impactafricaonline.com or tweet @UImpactAfrica. Now, back to our show.
Welcome back to Impact Africa, and yes, I promised you that I was going to have people from OPIC with me, and they're here from the Overseas Private Investment Corporation. And I have Chinesom Ejiasa, and I have Charles Stadtlander. And welcome to the show, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, honestly, I know that the first question on the minds of people that are watching is, OPIC, what does that have to do with me? Isn't that some government agency somewhere? Isn't that like Department of Treasury?
Well, I'm glad you asked. I mean, we actually are a government agency, but what we do is we empower U.S. businesses to conduct game-changing investments, positive development impact in countries across the developing world.
Good.
Everything from agriculture to healthcare to electricity and power projects. We use the tools of U.S. business to have a positive impact in the emerging markets around the world.
Nice. That's very interesting. So before I go to what you do, people will be asking me, so Chinesom, it sounds like a Nigerian name, but when we were arranging this, it's all from Colorado.
Yes.
Where are you from?
We're from, family's from Nigeria. I'll give background. Yeah, family came, parents came, 1971, 1972 from Nigeria to the States. I grew up in the States. Certainly, though, my family, my roots go back to Nigeria. So I'm a Nigerian man born and raised in Colorado.
Okay. I like that. Nigerian man born and raised in Colorado. Yeah. And so one of the things that I like about you all being here is that there are people like you, like me, who have roots in Africa and they want to do something.
Yeah.
And, you know, so we call ourselves diaspora or something. So how does OPIC help me help Africa or, you know, do something?
So much like what Charlie said, I mean, the focus of OPIC is multifaceted, but one of the key points is that you're trying to take U.S. businesses and impart knowledge, impart wisdom, impart finance into the emerging market space. The diaspora are a key link to that because the diaspora are here in the States. They have businesses, they have ideas, and they want to basically take their knowledge back into their home country. They should use OPIC essentially to get financing to actually do that. So OPIC has a broad range of financing opportunities from a dollar amount of $1 million up to $250 million.
Okay.
And like Charlie said, it's a broad range of financing.
Yes. Wow, $1 million to $250 million. So what Chinesom is saying now is that OPIC does not give out money. This is not, you know, a charitable cause of, oh, yeah, you know, I'm in the diaspora and I want to come get money. But at the same time, this is not like walking into a commercial bank here. So you're somewhere in the middle.
That's exactly right. So we do offer loans and insurance policies. Those are to be repaid. However, we offer those in places and at terms that business people would never get from private lenders. We are able to offer favorable, encouraging rates of repayment that allow these kind of bold, intrepid business people to do business in some of the most difficult places around the world to obtain financing, to get a business up and running. And we exist to encourage that business activity.
And I want to hear about some of those places where you've done business and some of those kind of businesses that you've done, because people need to be able to relate to, okay, so yes, they're talking a good game, but what have you really done?
So let's talk high level. So we, like Charlie said, we'll do electricity. There's Power Africa, which is a massive initiative that started in 2013, June. Obama was in Kenya when it was announced, and it was essentially to electrify Africa. So some of the projects that we've done in Nigeria, in particular in Edo State, there's a 459 megawatt gas turbine facility where OPIC is providing $50 million of financing, along with other development financial institutions and private sector funders, equity funders and debt funders. So you have that, a large project. You have another project in Togo, closely next door, that is a $209 million investment from OPIC, both in the way of insurance and in financing. It's a 100 megawatt plant. So you've got these big, massive electrification plants, and then you also have medical facilities and healthcare facilities. We have one in Luanda in Angola that we gave about $9.8 million, or roughly $10 million, to a diagnostic center. We have Bell Star in Ghana, where we've given money for them to procure and administer medical equipment and services across Ghana. We have a water purification facility in Ghana. We have Bridge Academies in Kenya, which is a primary school initiative for kids who are trying to improve their educational systems. And then we also have agriculture, because agriculture is obviously one of the largest initiatives across the continent of Africa. It's the industry that employs the most people across Africa. So we were supporting a business in Senegal that is actually acquiring tractors and equipment to help facilitate and improve their delivery of agriculture across Senegal.
You know, and this is great. I'm in awe. The Edo State Power Project, I think, is going to really be fantastic, and the capacity in Togo is also very impressive. But when I'm listening to this, I'm thinking there's no space for me, a small business.
Well, that's exactly the opposite. I mean, it's in some of these businesses that we have empowered to expand in Africa, just two or three people at the start, and they grow from there. I mean, we offer growth tools. It's U.S. business people that might exist in a small form here, or they have a great idea that is ripe for expansion, but through the tools and financing that we're able to offer, they can grow their business and start small and get big, and then with the impressive and amazing opportunities that there are to be had in a lot of the African countries.
So that means that, you know, if I'm just really small right now. I can come to you. So how does somebody who is in the diaspora right now, you know, watching this and wants to do something, come to you? How do they get involved with OPIC? Because it's like opic.gov is just so huge. Like,
right. So from a business level standpoint, I think one of the most important things is to have a proven business plan to start and come to us with a fully developed plan for how your business can expand. But then after that initial proof is laid out, that's when we can come in and offer the tools that you would need to take the next step.
So you do not fund, like, I just have an idea to develop Nigeria. That's not what you're looking for.
No, it needs to be. And look, OPIC isn't going anywhere. For the time being, we'll be around for some time. So to Charlie's point, take your time, put together a well-thought-out business plan, because this isn't grant funding. I think what we're trying to exhibit and illustrate is that Africa, much like all the other emerging markets, need investment finance, not grant money, although grant money is good in certain instances. This is investment finance. So take your time, put together your business plans, come into OPIC, we'll be here, we're down the street. and the range of financing goes from structured finance all the way down to $1 million up to $250 million. There's insurance, political risk insurance, and then there's also private equity funding as well. So we are here to stay. Take your time, put together a coherent business plan, because as you can imagine, there's a lot of opportunities that come into the door, and we want to find the really good ones.
And so, give me an example of some of the people in the diaspora who have come to OPIC and they have, you know, gone ahead to do something.
Sure.
In Africa.
So what Jin had mentioned with the company Bellstar, who we worked with in Ghana, we've done several projects with them there. One was water purification for increasing access there, and then also medical modernization. Those are Ghanaian Americans who we worked with out of Florida.
Oh, nice. They
came to us, and they have the U.S. business practice that they were familiar with from here, but then they also had a foot in Ghana, and their eyes were looking towards Ghana and what they could do to make it better there. One of the best ways that young diaspora members in America can get involved with us is we have a series of small business outreach workshops around the country. They're called Expanding Horizons. You can read more about all of this on www.opic.gov. The next Expanding Horizons workshop, it's going to be in Detroit in May. We're going to be in Long Beach, California in June. Then in the fall, we're going to be in Nashville and Boston. And if you're anywhere near any of those four locations, you know, we encourage you to come out. This is an all-day seminar which you can learn exactly about which stage of business you need to be at, which tools are available to you, and how you can expand and how you can grow.
And are these free to attend or no?
There's a very small fee associated with it, but it's money very well spent, because you have full open access to not just OPIC personnel and OPIC consultants there, but a number of U.S. government tools that would be available to you, and as well as engagement with the local private sector business chambers from these regions. And we've seen tremendous, not just African diaspora, and I know that's what we're here to talk about.
Yes.
We've had Latino American, Arab American, Indian American, and in all of these countries around the world, much like in Africa, as you said, these are the people that have the sort of bold vision and dedicated passion to carry out these projects.
And so what makes, you know, I know OPIC works with, you know, different countries, different continents, but there is something that really draws an African back to Africa. And how much success compared to other continents have you had in terms of involvement from the African diaspora?
In terms of the African diaspora, I can't answer that question specifically. What I can say is that over the last 7 to 8 years, our exposure to the African continent is trifolded. So it went from, and Charlie can correct me on the terms, but around 6% in 2008 to now around a quarter of our portfolio. And our portfolio is $18 billion.
Wow.
So if you take a quarter of
that's
that,
huge.
Over the last 8 years, our exposure and our focus on Africa is trifolded. So there is a dedicated effort to support the initiative that's going on across the African continent.
Wow. So what are you waiting for? If you have a business that needs to be financed, you better go to OPIC.
Exactly. But
for real, this is very important, because I didn't even think before we connected, I didn't think that OPIC even did anything with private sector. these are misconceptions that people, you know, sure. have. Or even with individual Africans in the diaspora, I thought it was just a government-to-government initiative. So this is really great. If it's the quarter of the portfolio, there is money to be made in Africa, no doubt. Yes. There is.
And that's exactly it. We actually don't lend money to governments. We only lend to private businesses, and we exist to strengthen those private businesses and help them feel confident enough to go and do business.
So one final word. Mm. If I want to come to you, because I know you're one of the people that would review, you know, my proposal and make the decision, apart from the fact that, you know, we're close from the south,
South
Nigeria. Close, yeah. Apart from that, what else would you be looking for?
Well, there's a handful of initiatives that we have now, agriculture being one, renewable energy being another. But I think a large part of our diaspora are probably focused on either agriculture or electricity, some sort of power initiative. But that being said, we're looking at any project that's viable. It's got to be revenue generating, so it can't be an idea that one woke up with one morning and wrote down on paper. There needs to be some sustainability behind the idea and some proof to concept that this is actually a sustainable business. Outside of that, any sector, any industry, OPIC is quite keen to support. And again, there's some ranges in terms of how low we can go in financing, how high we can go in financing. Stay within those parameters and we're good to go.
So $1 million to...
$250 million.
You know, I'm always talking about getting $1 million on Facebook, so I'm going to be calling you, okay? I'm going to be calling you, but that's really great. I think this is wonderful, and I'm hoping that people will connect with you. And the expanding horizon is something that we would also continue to send out via Twitter as well. So please make sure that I have that.
Very happy. Great. Yeah.
Yes. So this is great. Thank you so much for coming on Impact Africa.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you very much for coming.
You're welcome.
And I hope that we will see more diaspora involvement and more financing, you know, for these projects in the future. So you're still watching Impact Africa. When we come back, we have some other change makers that are doing something really wonderful for their alma mater in Nigeria. So please don't go away.
You are listening to Impact Africa. To connect with the program, please call 1-443-499-2755. That's 1-443-499-2755. You may also send an email to info@impactafricaonline.com or tweet @UImpactAfrica. Now, back to our show.
Welcome back to Impact Africa, and these ladies are really threatening me. They were telling me to give them the answers to the Africa 101 quiz, but I'm very delighted to welcome my sisters to this show. I have Miss Abimbola Art Alade, and if you're familiar with the Nigerian art scene, you probably have heard Art Alade, and if you haven't, you've been living under a rock. But I have Abimbola Art Alade, and I have Mojupe Olatunji Adekombi, the president and the vice president of the Federal Government Girls College Sagamu U.S. Alumni Group. And welcome to the show, first of all, ladies.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Tope.
And, you know, they had a very impressive and very inspiring event yesterday at the Hyatt in Bethesda. It was a reunion of the old girls, but it wasn't just a reunion, it wasn't just a party. It was also a chance to flesh out ideas for getting involved, for giving back, which is what we're talking about on Impact Africa. And that's why I thought it would be very nice to have them on the show today. So, welcome. I want to talk about some of the projects that you have planned. One of them is on health and wellness.
Yes. Thanks, Tokwe, and thanks for having us here. We do have a couple of projects that we would like to roll out to our to the girls in the school that we went to, Federal Government Girls College, Sagamu. The health and wellness program is one that we envision will be an educational program for the girls, where we'll be touching on several topics throughout the months. We have a calendar we want to roll out. So the thought process is that some of this items on our calendar will be geared to as specific things that we know are challenges from a health perspective. Some things that that we believe that it would have been great for us to know.
Yes.
But be it either we didn't have access to it, and you know, and maybe ignorance. Nobody to tell us.
Yes, was doing it, and now.
Yes. I mean, now that we are in a position, we have this accessibility to the information, we can get it back to the girls, you know. So, and one of the other goals is to make sure that some of those items actually line up with some of the global health initiatives that we have all over the world. So yes, we know that there's some programs, for example, breast cancer awareness, mm-hmm, from a World Health Organization perspective is, you know, it's at a certain time, you know, every year. So yes, we want to use all the tools and resources that we have available to us here to gather as much information as possible and send it back to the girls. It's really simple. Information is knowledge.
Yeah.
And, you know, the little bit that they have with them helps them actually ask more questions and want to know about, you know, all those things. So we're going to touch on different, I'm excited about this. Because, like I said, if there are so many things that we had known back then when we were growing up at
Tell
home,
me.
We probably all say this, we would do things differently.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes, absolutely.
And so that's the goal, is that for us to just be a good resource, because we have that accessibility here.
Yes.
Why can't we take it and take it to the next level
and transfer it back home? Because I went to Sagamu as well, and I know that living with all these people, this communal living, one of the key priorities has to be healthcare.
Yeah.
You know, you're living in this small space with all these women. But, you know, health and wellness, great number one agenda. I love that. But there's also something the whole world is talking about.
Technology.
You know, and there's a shortage of women in the technology space. And that's one of your goals.
Correct. So thank you, Tokwe, for bringing that up. We do have as one of our projects to revamp the internet infrastructure that the school currently has so that there will be wireless access all over the school area. And as you say, knowledge is power.
Mm-hmm.
If we give them that that availability to be able to log on, mm-hmm, anywhere, the teachers, the students,
mm-hmm,
they'll be able to access information readily. They'll be able to keep up with the information that's out there. Mm-hmm. And for the girls specifically, we know that girls are underrepresented in the technology area right now.
Yes.
And a lot of effort is being put into that globally, mm-hmm. to help women to become, to empower them, to educate them, to equip them to become contenders in the technology area. And so that's why we're pushing the Internet Connectivity Project. And then moving forward from there, we're going to have a coding club established.
Fantastic.
You know, so for those girls that are interested in coding, we'll provide the tools for them and support them so that they can contend with their peers anywhere in the world. That is our goal.
That's fantastic. There was one thing you said yesterday that I really liked, and that is, you know, maybe the next Sheryl Sternberg will come from Sagamu.
Yes.
You never know.
You just never know. And this is, you know, everybody has this initiative, and somehow we seem to be lagging behind. But of course, one of the big things to these are good projects. One of the big things that you have challenges with is funding.
Oh, absolutely.
It's funding. What's the plan? And, you know, how can people support?
Well, so, I mean, as you mentioned earlier, we had our reunion yesterday, last night at the Hyatt Regency in Bethesda, and it wasn't just about partying. We actually used that focus as an outreach.
It wasn't about partying alone?
No, I mean, oh, yeah. We did do even lots of that.
Yeah, even though we did lots of that, we had a good time.
I was about to say, you could have fooled me.
It was a great time, but it was awesome for me because a lot of our girls showed up. A lot of our girls listened, and they are going to, I strongly believe, put their money
where their mouth is.
But to your answer on the funding, where we want to start from us. Charity begins at home.
Absolutely.
I'm hoping that with us, when we start putting things out there, we will get, you know, the funding that we need. But then we're also putting a strategy together to reach out to any organization, all organizations,
yes.
Individuals, anybody that wants to support us in any way. And honestly speaking, it doesn't all just have to be about money. Honestly, I don't want it to all be about money.
Yes.
We want, you know, anyone that has access to any kind of resources, books, software,
expertise. Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
That's what I was about to say. So the knowledge.
Yes.
You say, all right, you know what? You know, an example, a friend said, you know what? Maybe you guys don't want to buy X kind of piece laptop. So, you know, or make sure you do your research to mm-hmm. make sure that what you buy and take back there will be compatible. So many things that we may not as individuals just know about. So any kind of resource,
yes.
you know. Be it just to tell me everything is negative, because that way, even if it's negative feedback, this just drives us.
Yes,
right?
And it just challenges you.
It just challenges.
It does.
And we welcome every kind of challenge, because that's what's going to make a very, very good foundation.
Fantastic.
And to add to that, you asked how people can support us.
We
have a website, www.fggcsalumniusa. If you go to that website, we have a support us link. You can mm-hmm. click on that link. You can support us financially. If you have other means of support that you want to provide to us, you can also go to the contact us link on that website and just send us a message, put in your contacts, obviously, and we will get back to you and follow
up. So it's the website once again.
www.fggcsalumniusa.com.
Fantastic. So, and we're going to send that out to Twitter as well. But before I let you go, you know how this works. You have to have a quiz. This is my chance to quiz my seniors, okay? Yep. So, and I'm going to make sure I hide the paper.
Okay?
I'm going to hide the paper so that you guys don't see the answer. But we have 5 minutes on the clock.
Oh, gosh.
So 3 minutes out of this 5 minutes, you're going to use to answer this question. This is about a very, you know, important... Oh, my goodness. This is a problem. This is going to be a problem. This is about Margaret Ekpo, a very, very, very important person in Nigeria's history.
Can we call a friend?
You cannot. This is the only friend you can call.
So, okay, where's one?
So let's see. So we start with you. What Nigerian state was Margaret Ekpo born in?
Calabar.
State. And this is going to be multiple choice. So I can give you the options. Two options. A, Akwa Ibom. B, Cross River.
Call a friend.
You're my friend.
Cross River.
And that is correct. Cross River. And you got the capital at the beginning. So let's go to her question.
I thought maybe it was a trick question. After that. I'm pretty sure it's
Cross River,
but now you got me stumped. I got the, you're right. I was in a hurry to get the answer.
Nice. So maybe you might help her now. So, Bimbo, in what city did Margaret Ekpo lead grassroots movements? A, Calabar. B, Aba.
B.
Aba. That is correct.
All right, we're on a roll now.
Okay. So, number three, aside from Nigeria, what country did Margaret Ekpo study in? A, Ghana. B, Ireland.
My friend is telling me it's B.
And that is correct. Ireland. Wow. This is I should call her next time I need, you know, help on this quiz.
Yeah, my
you know what?
She got your back.
Yeah, she really does.
Is there something in it for us after this?
Yeah.
What?
I will tell you after you get all 10 questions correctly. After you get all 10 questions correctly. So how did Margaret Ekpo get her start in politics? A, she attended meetings to discuss discrimination by the colonial administration in her husband's stead. B, her sister invited her to join a political rally.
Oh, that's yours.
That's yours.
No, that's yours.
What was the first one?
She attended meetings to discuss discrimination by the colonial administration in her husband's stead.
How old is she again?
That might be one of the questions coming up, so I can't tell you.
B.
No, it's A. She attended meetings in her husband's stead. Okay, well, you still have a chance to get an A.
That's good. We're learning.
Yep. And this is a very important woman in Nigeria's history. I didn't know too much about her as well. So this is great. So, what group of women in Aba did Margaret Ekpo help to unionize? A, the market women. B, the farmers. Yes, correct. The market women. So we'll go back to you, Bimbo. What political party was Margaret Ekpo a part of? The Commoners People's Party. B, the National Council of Nigerians and the Cameroons.
A.
No, it's National Council of Nigerians and the Cameroons.
I'm sorry.
Okay, well, we still have a chance. We still have a chance here. So, Mojupe, what did Margaret Ekpo and Fumilayo Ransom-Kuti protest together? A, the withholding of salaries of housemaids. B, killings at the Enugu coal mine.
B.
Killings at the Enugu coal mine. Correct. I didn't even know that they had a partnership, you know, Fumilayo Ransom-Kuti and Margaret Ekpo. You know, two very impressive women. So we're almost to the end. Number eight, Margaret Ekpo had a seat in the Eastern Regional House of Assembly in 1961. True or false?
Oh. True.
True. That is correct. And number nine.
Can redeem myself.
What is named after Margaret Ekpo in Calabar? A, the Calabar Airport. B, a library. If you go to Nigeria a lot, you should know this.
Are you calling a friend?
I'm calling a friend.
A.
It is correct. Your friend is correct.
Yes.
And last but not the least, and both of you can help each other out on this one. When did Margaret Ekpo die? A, 1960. B,
1996. 1960.
We just said that she was in the House of Assembly in 1961.
I wasn't listening to the question.
Well, actually, it has to be 96 because if she, it couldn't be 60 because I don't think we had the House of Assembly back then.
You know what?
So
it's 1996.
Yeah, 1996.
So thank you very much for participating. You get bragging rights. That's what you get.
Oh, I thought I was getting a grade like an A.
Well, yeah, you get an A. That's 70 because you missed only three questions. But thank you so much for participating.
Thank you for coming.
And thank you for giving back. You know, we're going to tweet out the website once again. It's FGGC.
FGGCSAlumniUSA.com.
FGGCS alumniusa.com. And I want to put this out there that all donations are tax deductible because the alumni group is a 501c3 exempt organization.
Thank you for mentioning that. Yes. That's I think that's it's a good point.
Yes.
You know, you can give back and
Get back get in your back taxes from and get back from Uncle Sam. So
and
thank
get
you.
Back from Uncle Sam. Absolutely.
Thank you so much for coming on the show today. Thank you for watching, everybody. So if you want to connect with any of my guests, so please make sure you contact us at You Impact Africa on Twitter, OPIC, Startup Africa, and the FGGC Sagamu Alumni USA. These are all wonderful organizations doing fantastic work. And until I meet you again next week, please keep impacting Africa. Good morning.
Thank you for tuning in to Impact Africa. Please join us again next Sunday at 9 a.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. GMT at listenvisionlive.com. Have a good week and keep impacting Africa.